Okay, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. So this is a follow-up talk on the last one. I guess most of you have even seen the last one, so I won't go into the very deep details on reproducible builds, but start up with introduction on this topic. So in general, where does the code come from which we use? There's a developer which pushes this code to a Git repo. And in the Git repo, it's pretty safe because it's all indexed by SHA-sums, checksums. From there, it goes into a tarball, and if the developer does it right, he signs the tarball using GPG, so there's no easy way to manipulate it there either. Then comes the packager and throws the tarball into the open build service. Then magic happens. And we get a binary RPM, which is signed by the build service, and repositories that are also signed. And those go to the mirrors, and because they are signed, they can't be manipulated by the mirror operators and other agencies. And then it gets to the user. And what reproducible builds is really about is the magic that happens during the build, because you want to be able to verify is this really the source that produces the binary and under what circumstances. So that their secret services and other interested parties can't backdoor your binaries there. So how do we know it? That they don't contain extra backdoors. Yeah, we try to rebuild it. And ideally, it would be bit by bit identical, but since that is a bit hard to start with, we try the weaker version for now. We apply some content filtering, like dropping timestamps of the files, ignoring these. And that is what our build compare tool does in the open build service. It applies some filtering, but overall the binaries are still doing the same thing. And doing that, during the last months, being inspired by Holger's talk on FOSDEM, I ran it on just one machine, not 30, and the code is also only 50 lines maybe, and that's much less. But I could build on all the infrastructure, which is OBS, all the packages being available from there, even though not the old versions, but the current versions. And we have the OSC tool, which sets up a whole build environment from scratch. And that's a pretty standardized environment, so we have one path to build under, and we have mostly the environment variables set to a defined value, so there are no different locales and time zones in these things. So it's a bit easier for us. And that as a result, if we really manage to build all packages in a reproducible build, need less trust in the build hosts, because we could take the binaries and reproduce them, and if it's still the same, we know, yes, they are not manipulated. And the other nice advantage is why we actually did the build compare in the first place. When we change a package, then we need to rebuild depending packages on the build service, so we have a new glibc. We need to rebuild binaries against the new glibc to know that the ABIs, the binary interfaces between applications and libraries still match. And when we know that our rebuild glibc is actually still the same old one, then we don't have to rebuild all the dependent packages. And that reduces load on our service, which is also a good thing. So what fails typically? Yes, timestamps, he mentioned it. Sometimes you also have a host name embedded in your results. Sometimes you have the rebuild counters in the results, but that's actually pretty rare. And in one case, I saw a package that did compile time CPU detection. And that's really evil because when we schedule two different build servers, it might happen to run on a build server that supports SSE4. And if you deploy that package on a less modern host, it will create some CPU faults on the SSE4 instruction. And that's something which you wouldn't even want. So I guess that's an actual bug, not just reproducibility failure. So what's the current state of the art there? I went through all the packages in 42.1 and later in factory. I did 71 submit requests so far, of which 70 are already accepted. 6 bugs were filed and also plenty of them fixed, and I had 4 upstream fixes merged on GitHub. So even Debian gets some benefit from it now. And Olaf Hering added some extra filters to the build compare because the filters always need updating when the date time formats change, like with Java doc, so that ignores some extra known timestamps now. And on that page, we can have a quick look at the browser. So I kept an Etherpad to keep track of what I did, and on there is a list of packages in alphabetical order, and sometimes, let's say, this one, there was, for example, maybe a timestamp in this binary, and then I took note, and on others we have, that's compiled Emacs Lisp things, and so we have a lot of packages. I think 270 it was that were sort of affected, and left over are somewhere around 137 of the overall 8,800. That's calculated to be around 1.5%, which is okay, but that's a weaker similarity requirement. So, not really bitwise identical yet, but it's still quite a good thing to have. So then we have public the compare results in different directories on my servers, and I sent the links to the factory mailing list before, so people could have a look. And if you looked in there, this one. You could see that there were some differences for example, containing the build date. And then you see, yes, it's maybe not good to have the build date, and then you can see the difference in there. And I think the factory ones are the more current ones, so more interesting. And the 42.1 compare results are more outdated. Then the submit requests I send are typically of format, just a few lines changed, like we had a changelog entry here, which was added by the getTextDice call, and that added the current build date, and you didn't even want it, so by just dropping the extra entry, we made it reproducible. Okay, and sometimes I filed bugs where I showed the diff, and this one is still outstanding. And there's some upstream contributions, like Jack Audio that now supports the source date epoch variable. And if that is given, it uses that one instead of the current date. Or, we have packages that use the current year in a copyright statement, which is sort of strange, because if I compile it in 2018, it says copyright 2018, but there wasn't even an author active. So lucky that one is merged. And Yeah, another typical string. People use convert from the ImageMagick package to create their PNG files, and that adds timestamps by default. I guess people don't even know that, but once you add the strip option, it drops these timestamps, and then you have more reproducible packages for everyone. And that's actually a common pattern. I think I had over 20 packages doing this, sometimes even in the spec files in OpenSUSE. So that was also a place where ImageMagick calls were fixed. Yeah, and then there are the many, many packages like Cobbler, which use a very own method of embedding build dates, and then you have to go through these individually and patch the build date in there by a more constant build date, like the one from changelog. Yeah, and then when you look at build results, you can see next to the RPM, not within the RPM, a file called underscore build env, which you can download for each of the build packages. And when you do that, it looks like this one. So of course we are all modern and use XML. And in there, you have pretty much the same build info stuff like the MD5 sums of the source packages, of the build binaries, of the dependencies, and even where the dependencies came from. So we know that the bash package had MD5 sum DC something. So in principle, if we have all the old packages around, we could fetch exactly these and use these to build. Question? That build env file is produced in the open build service, but maybe if we do local builds, it might also be produced. Let me have a look. So we have a lot of .build files created here, and there's a .build env even. That's not the one. This is not the file you're looking for. Okay, so maybe. Build RPM. Somewhere there. Oops. Other. We have other, and then we have only an RPM lint log. So maybe, or maybe it wasn't built correctly. That could also be the case sometimes. So, okay, maybe the worker is creating the file, and then it's more part of OBS and not of local builds. But that is to be seen. Yeah, only an RPM lint log. So not, it's not in local builds, for example, but yeah, maybe it could be patched. It should not be impossible, because the local build does fetch the build info file with all the dependencies and get the file, so it could also write a log about the MD5 sums. .osc what?
Oh, thank you. It's in the .osc file in the directory where you have the package. So you have a underscore build whatever. Where's the package list? Where is the package source?
We don't know. Anyway, yeah, so we, in principle, we can build such a build environment, and maybe we should do it more often, even in local builds. And that would make it easier for people to share this information and compare it with each other. Okay. So, a lot of changes then. What else? Yeah, we have the test scripts in a GitHub repo available, and even the source codes in Markdown format of this very presentation are there. And yeah, the rebuild scripts are very simple, 50 lines, and just to trigger the OSC build command in the right way and multiple times and vary in the current time and the host name. And I even tried if we can build bit by bit identical RPMs. And I found we can. It takes a few patches. I think one patch on RPM and one on build. And it created some uncleanliness because it would overwrite the file timestamps of the actual files. And some packages like Python put pre-compiled PUC files in there, and they contain file timestamps of the relating source file. And if they don't match up, it doesn't use the cached version. And that's not what we want. So that's one of the reasons why we don't push these changes to factory yet. But at least we know that it's in principle possible to really build identical, bit by bit identical RPMs if you really want to. But it's hard. So where do we want to go from my side? I want to see more build compare issues fixed. That will happen more or less automatically with the new GCC version, because there is a patch to support the source date epoch variable. And once we set that one to a constant date, like the changelog date, it will also always use that one for the date and time macros in C source files. And that patch is even backported to our GCC 6 and factory. Thanks to Richard. Yeah. And yeah, I don't think we want to go to fully bit by bit identical RPMs, especially because we have the signatures in there, and maybe we don't want to put old dates in there and host names and these things. All pretty useful to have for debugging reproducibility and other issues. Like the CPU compile time detection, we would need to know on which host was it compiled and compare these things. So yeah, I don't think we should do it yet. Or do you think we should? Holger thinks yes. Microphone? Or?
I think the build host should be stored in a build end file or something, and the signature part, if you need to sign the RPM, so that somebody needs to sign this with a private key.
Yeah.
But then you have a signature, and this signature is detached and will match the same binary. So when you do a rebuild, you can take the signature and apply it again, and you get bit by bit identical RPMs.
Yeah,
but we are also with Fedora people discussing this, how to do this best.
Yeah, I think currently
possible.
I think currently we have the signature embedded in the RPM. But yeah, I guess you could even if you manage to build the same RPM, you could put the same signature back in and still have the same binary result.
So the RPM signature is defined as on the content excluding the signature. So Holger is right that if everything else is the same, the signature will be the same, and then you can put, then the resulting sign signal RPM will be the same again.
Okay, yeah, so that could be the goal.
One other example where this happened or is happening is the Linux signed kernels. The Debian kernel packages are also now signed, but it's a different package which just contains the signature for that reason. But you have the same problem with signed kernels. But
yeah, so I guess it's a bit easier with detached signatures, because then you can just put them next to the actual RPM, and the RPMs can be identical, and the detached signatures don't matter for the checksum. Yeah, or you just define this is a signature portion and that's ignored for checksumming. I think, yeah, we have these DVDs where we have signature or hash checks on the DVD itself, and that also defines a portion of the DVD that is not included in the checksum. And that's what Kiwi and InitID does already. Yeah, so I guess somewhat in that direction. Yeah, that's pretty much it for the presentation. I guess we can add some minutes of discussion about how useful is reproducibility, how many do we want to have 100% reproducible OpenSUSE? Mikro?
Hello?
Yeah.
Did you play with the SPIP non-deterministic key thingy on OpenSUSE?
I tried it, yes. It sort of worked, but on a limited set of file formats, of course. And of course, for it to work in a build environment, you would need to add it as a build requires, and I think it's Python 3. And not sure if we want to add Python 3 as a build requirement to so many packages.
Yeah, but RPM build is two. RPM build is two part of our, so it's already also Python. We could use the same thing there. And
okay.
If it's part of the build environment, use it. From what I understood in the first demo talk, the tool is tested.
Yeah.
Or in testing? What's the Debian term?
So is it tested?
Did I get correctly that your problem with script non-determinism is that it's Python 3? Your problem with script non-determinism is that it's Python 3?
No, the problem is that if you add it to the build requires list, it could create build cycles and blow up the dependency tree. And
because of Python or because of Python 3?
I think it's similar. But I don't know, so I guess at least for the low-level packages like Bash and RPM, we don't want to use it, but maybe for the higher-up packages, it doesn't make much of a difference.
Is there a reason why in the build environment files there are MD5 checksums instead of SHA-1 or something like?
I guess that is what RPM does, because every RPM has a section where it puts MD5 sums of its content, and we didn't go so far as redefining the RPM format yet. Because that is sort of shared with Red Hat, and there's some interoperability issues involved. But I guess for our purposes, it is still good enough.
So this is not for security, this is for identifying. And for identifying, MD5 sum is pretty much still fine.
Yeah, right. For the repositories themselves, we have real GPG. Checksums on the repo files, which use char something checksums for the actual files. So yes, some stronger hashes involved.
The kernel packages, the Holger already mentioned that that's already signed and actually it's true. So that, for example, so the Linux Enterprise kernel package cannot be reproducible on the local user bridge because the signed keys is private. So it's not distributed.
Yeah, I guess the easiest would be if the signature would be separate and you just check some the remaining file or something.
Can just reuse the signature if it's the same. We have the same problem with the wireless RecDB package for the wireless thing, which has to be signed by the developer. And so when we rebuild it, you just reuse the sign, the signature. And SIM is the next thing.
The problem is about the secure boot things. So for the secure boot, we needed to sign so that Microsoft agrees and not the user side.
Okay, yeah, so when you're able to really reproduce the binary, you can still reuse the old signature, which is a good thing. Okay, if there are no more questions, then I thank you all for joining and have a lot of fun.